Tyler, forgive me for this angle. I'm just going to say it. You know, you are incredibly good looking, as so are you, Pascal. You both could be brothers. But we're directing this one to Tyler. But I'm wondering, do people ever think that maybe he's pretty, but he can't act until they see you act, and then they know he can? Wow, he's got a huge range of emotion. But when you first go somewhere, because especially LA is very visual.
Sure.
Do you think that sometimes they feel like, oh, this guy's really good looking, but you know what? I don't know if we're going to be able to cast him.
Well, I mean, first let me say I'm flattered that you would say so. But yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, this is a business of aesthetics, so it certainly is a factor. But to your question, absolutely. I think it's one of the things that I try to capitalize on as much as possible, which is the under expectation that can often go with the way that we stereotype someone based upon their looks. So, you know, for me, I kind of use it to my advantage. I'm someone who prides myself on craftsmanship. I really take this job very seriously. I take the work very seriously. It's very near and dear to my heart. And the result is that, you know, I kind of want you to count me out a little bit at certain times.
Really? So you almost want to surprise people a little bit that, like, wow, I didn't think he could go there.
Which, absolutely.
If you watch the film, you definitely see that. But at first glance, maybe they would just think, oh, wow, this guy's probably a model. But
right.
Then how do you do that? That's interesting. So you kind of almost catch him off guard a little bit.
Yeah, but at the same time, you know, you watch, like, the Avengers, for example. Everyone is super good looking and no one say anything about it. Like, oh, my God, they're so beautiful. No, they all in the story about the concept and they are involved in it. But when sometimes it's about an independent film, it's kind of easier to judge, like, oh, it's just beautiful people. No, it's not beautiful people. You want people who look like stars. You want people who look, you don't want something that looks kind of cheap or independent. You want them to look like stars. And when you look at this beautiful, pretty face, he looked like a star. And that's why I casted him in the film.
Sure, but and I don't want to give away too many of the scenes, but in your film, On the Horizon, the depth of, you know, the emotion that we see from him is definitely not what you'd see just quote-unquote pretty people doing. I mean, there's a definite range and there's some dark moments too. So where do you think you pull from some of that? Because sometimes they think, well, if somebody's pretty, then they've had it really good and they don't really have that in them, even though
sure.
We all do, but...
Yeah, you know, my upbringing plays a large part in forming a lot of the decisions I make. With regards to script work and character work, I think we all have our struggles. I think we've all battled our demons, and I'm no exception. And I think that as far as Casey is concerned, you know, one of the things that really drew me to him was the way that he internalizes emotions to such a degree. And I always described it as impotent rage, mm-hmm. Which is funny because in one scene, that may or may not come to pass, but yeah. So from that angle, from that perspective, we've all experienced our traumas.
Sure.
And we all got to draw on.
Sure, and I'm not here to go into what they are, but I appreciate you sharing that. I'm wondering, when you do go into a scene that's like that, are you going back to certain things? And you don't have to share what they are, but is that where you can draw upon, like when you were in the desert together? In some of those scenes, I know it was a small crew.
Well, I mean, substitution works, and it does work, but up to a point. There is a point where something, there has to be a substitution for a substitution, and in this case, it's making the relationship real, the relationship between Casey and Alyssa, and the relationship between myself and the actress who played Alyssa. I mean, it's intense to shoot a story like the one that we did, 12 hours a day, 14 hours a day kind of thing, and then detach yourself from it afterwards. So I know that, you know, when we would fight, we would fight, and that would carry over. And, you know, and even the next day on set, you know, we'd kind of have to, he'd bring us together and we had to resolve some things maybe from the night before.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it was natural to the relationship, and it was really interesting for me that when we really got going, there wasn't a ton of acting that needed to be done because the prep work had set everything in motion. His directing had set everything in motion, and at that point, it was as real as it could be, and it was as real it got a little uncomfortable sometimes, which is very cool.
Because that's the thing, when you're shooting with, we were three, the whole crew was three people, me, the sound guy, and an assistant. So we were such a tight family. So of course, sometimes we just like bump head. Me and Tyler, I think it was once that we kind of bumped head. And it was my fault because I'm like a freaking immigrant. And the way I was using my word was totally wrong. But other than that, me and him was just working perfectly. But yeah, sometime on set, he and the lead, Elissa, sometimes we're bumping head. And then the next day, it was the big scene of just like, now it's time to hate each other. And it's the big confrontation. So please, now it's time to crank it up and really go at it. So I think when it's time to reach for those emotions, it was, you know, it was like, it's right here. So
Yeah, that was very apparent.
Yeah.
Getting back to just your acting career and how you're perceived. So you came from the world of modeling and then you've been in LA and I think you've just been signed, which congratulations.
Thank you, yeah.
So when you go out for an audition and you say you like to kind of surprise, do you maybe come in more subdued and then bring the range and people are kind of blown away? Is that what you're talking about?
You know, actually, to be honest, I actually think it's the opposite. It's funny, bravado, there's a very thin line between bravado, confidence, and arrogance. And I think as an actor, you have to toe that line. You know, you really have to understand, you really have to believe in the work that you're doing. You have to believe in the perspective that you're bringing to the material. You have to believe in the choices that you've made coming into the room. And so, I mean, the word that comes to mind is cocksure. Is that there's a certain cocksure attitude that you have to have, because if you're going to inspire confidence in a director, or in a casting director, in a producer, in a creative team, that confidence has to first start with yourself. So I would say rather than going in subdued or meek, I go in with, these are the choices I've made, this is the level of professionalism I'm bringing to the project, and let you draw your own opinions based upon that. So yeah, because I think it'd be too easy to go in subdued for me to just become exactly what they would want me to be, which is not what I am.
I know I've asked this question in other interviews, but if someone doesn't have that, whether you want to say cocksure or whatever it is, where do they find it? Because not everybody has it. They have voices from the past or whatever that are always like in their ear, even though those people may be long gone. But where does that come from if you don't already have it in you?
Well, I mean, I know I can only speak for myself, but I know exactly what you're saying, because for me, it comes from a deep vulnerability and from, it's sort of born out of insecurity, which is a little counterintuitive, but it's confidence born out of insecurity. So I'm aware of how insecure I can be and how I can let doubts creep into my mind. And it's my reaction to that, which is exactly what you're doing with the work. It's your reaction to the material that really drives the whole thing forward. It's the same thing with me in that regard, so yeah.
Tyler, when you came to LA, I'm sorry, how long ago was it? 3 years ago?
2 years ago.
2 years ago. Forgive me. Okay. Did you have a plan in place for auditioning and getting an agent and manager? And then if it didn't work out, you also had a backup plan?
That's a funny question. It's a very good question. So I have a very strong opinion with regards to plan Bs. I think that if you have a plan B, that life will push you to addressing and confronting that plan B. And so if that plan B is in place, it's all too easy to go with that. So with me, this is my plan A, B, C, D, all the way through Z. And the result is a feeling of resiliency that says anything external, any setbacks, any obstacles that are external are only going to be temporary, because my internal drive to get things done and to really make a name for myself in this business is only extinguishable by one thing, and that's the end of the road. So, yeah, so there's no stopping for me.
And I think as soon as you start thinking about a plan B, I think it's too late. I think you've given up right away. Even for me, it's hard. I've been trying to do this for like 12 years or something, and it's a long time. And if you think, oh, then I'm going to be a lawyer, I'm like, makes no sense. You know, it's like you commit And if it takes 30 years, it's going to take 30 years, but you cannot think about a plan B. Even if sometimes you're struggling, you want, you know, you want to die or whatever, it's like you have to keep pushing. You push, and then you hope that at one day something is going to happen. And after all those years, for me, now I'm at the point of doing my first feature film. Now I just got a funding for the second one. So it's like things start to move, but it takes, you know, 15 years or so. So you cannot think about a plan B. And the same thing, I think, for any kind of artist, painting, whatever, actors. As soon as you think that, I think it's kind of you're kind of killing your soul a little bit.
And you know, just to add one thing to that, so I'm a boxer. I started boxing in Brooklyn many years ago, and I now box out here as well. And they have a slogan in the gym above the ring, and it says, "It ain't easy." And it's supposed to apply to training and to, but it also extends into life as well. And I think that this business ain't easy. I know this is poor grammar, but this business ain't easy. Life ain't easy. A struggle isn't easy. And the result is that you know, you got to be tough to make it in this business, and you got to be resilient. And I think resiliency is the number one key, because you're going to get beaten down. Just like in boxing, but it's how you get back up that really makes a difference. So,
yeah. So cheesy.
Is that cheesy?
But I believe it though. The sign though, that's great. I mean, do you carry that sign sort of as a metaphor for your life? Let's suppose you had a bad audition, or sure. maybe one that was great, and mm-hmm. they loved you when you walked in the room. And of course, as Murphy's Law, you don't get it for right. some reason. So where are you when you don't get that phone call? Because a lot of times they don't call.
Sure. Well, you know, I think a lot of it has to do with where you're based. Are you process based, or are you more outcome based? And for me, I find myself at the happiest when I'm process. I have a process based mentality, and so the sort of consequence of that is that you become divorced from the outcome itself. And so if I went into the room, I did the kind of work that I set out to do. I made clear choices. I was prepared. Then ultimately, when I go in there, I'm doing it for me. I'm not doing it for the room. I'm not doing it for the director. I'm not even doing it for the material, really. I'm doing it for me. And when I walk out, that same kind of mantra holds true. I did it for me, and what they had, what their reaction was, that's, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Who cares about what they think? It's the same thing with the feature film. I did it for myself. Some will love it. Some will hate it. Some will love this guy, some will hate it. It's part of life, you know what I mean? It's like you cannot please anybody. As long as you gave your all, you did it for yourself, move on after that, you know what I mean? Think about something else. And even if I did a short film that wasn't successful, I didn't go into festivals or stuff like that, even people were like, oh my God, it's horrible. Move on, you know? You have to have a strong back to be able to get roll off a little bit, but you just move on, and just who cares? And I've told to actors so many times that they killed it, they did an amazing job, and it's like, but you're not right for it, but you did an amazing job, but just, you know, continue, keep pushing, and it's gonna happen. You just have, it's not just about doing an audition, you need to fit the role perfectly. So no, he's totally right what he just said.
And I also think it has a lot to do as well, it's sort of a gut check on what you're. And only you can answer this question for yourself, but what your motivations are in getting involved in any art form and any side of the camera. You know, I like to use, like, you know, the allegory of a cobbler, like a line of vendors. You know, you got one vendor who's got a set of shoes, and he says, "Hey, I'm selling shoes because I really want to get famous." You know, next guy down the line says, "You know, I'm selling shoes because I just really want to get rich." And the guy down on the third guy down the line says, "Hey, I'm selling shoes because I love making shoes. I love, here's the leather, it's been imported from here. Here are the laces. It's an age-old tradition," this kind of thing. And that kind of love, that kind of passion, that kind of craftsmanship.
Can beat anything.
Yeah, and that's something that, I mean, if there's one thing that I aspire to be, it's a craftsman. And I want to be that third cobbler, if at all possible.
So. Was there a time you can recount where, let's say you did get beaten down, you know, you're in LA, you get cut off in traffic, all this stuff happens, you're like, you know what, I'm not sure that I really want to be here anymore. And then you reminded yourself that I don't know what else I'd be doing other than this.
Yes. In fact, not too long ago, I came out here with an agent. And it was an agent who I was set up with because of a relationship I was in prior, a romantic relationship. And it just wasn't a good fit. And we parted ways not too long ago, and I had And I had a little bit of that dark night of the soul, to use a little save the cat terminology. But ultimately, I got picked up by someone who really believes in me, and who's really willing to stick their neck out for me, take a chance on me. And you know, during that dark night, I had to ask myself, you know, am I going to allow this one particular perspective to influence how I feel about myself, or am I going to be the driving force behind my own fate, my own destiny, whatever you want to call it? And ultimately, I felt like I gotta get in the driver's seat. So, and there's a lot of that in this business with this kind of passive attitude towards getting work, which is, I mean, I hope my phone rings. Well, you gotta make your phone ring. You know, you can't just wait for it to ring. It's not just gonna ring on its own. So
that was just sort of a one night process, or did it?
No, of course not. And there's been many, and I anticipate confronting many more of those sorts of gut check moments. But I think really what you have to defer back to is exactly like you started the question out on, which is, without having a plan B, you think, what else could I possibly do? What else could I be disconnected to? And for me, there is nothing else. So it's not a hard choice in those moments. It's more a question of, okay, what do we do now, as opposed to let's cut and run, you know? So, you know, they always say you got to fight your way out of the corner. You know, they're not just going to let you out. You got to fight your way out of the corner. Sorry, it goes back to boxing for me.
Yeah, I know.
Tyler, what's been your experience looking for an agent or manager? I know you came from New York, from the modeling world, and you did acting as a child as well. What's your process like looking for an agent or manager?
Well, I would say that one thing that a lot of people, I think, forget when they're soliciting representation is that it's as much an interview for you as it is an interview for them. And it really is not a question of who you're working with or the size of the agency. I think it really has to do with the passion that your representative has for you. And as such, I think a lot of times as actors, we go into these meetings looking for a certain outcome and just all too eager to sign on the dotted line when we hear the things that we want to hear. When in reality, you know, there are a lot of hard questions that you have to ask in reverse. And that's sometimes hard to do as an actor because, you know, there's a lot of insecurity in this business. I mean, the one thing that I've always been reminded of, and my mom does so lovingly, but also to make sure I stay responsible, but is that the second you finish your last job, you're unemployed. So. And that's the nature of this job. So sometimes when you're going for these meetings and whatnot, you feel like you're back on your heels, as opposed to, you know, where you should be, which is firm and centered. And how can we work together to achieve a mutually desired result and outcome? So for me, that means I have some questions when I go in there too. But I've been lucky enough, especially recently, just to come across a great team, a fantastic team, who I really believe in, and we're very new to one another, so I'm very excited for the future.
Yeah. I know I've talked to other actors, and they've said that, you know, they felt that their agent or manager wasn't giving them the attention that they need, and they understood because they had, quote, bigger clients to deal with. But if an actor's feeling that, like maybe phone calls aren't returned and mm-hmm. things, you know, like at what point do they say either I'm being too demanding or no, these are red flags and I need to move on?
I mean, that is also a great question. That's tough to say because I think that there are two sides to that. On one side, I think a lot of times actors rely too heavily on their managers. They lean on them and their agent's representation, and they become their representation becomes a sort of scapegoat for the success that maybe they're not having at the moment. When I feel like rather than turn it externally, I feel like a lot of the work should be turned internally, and you have to really ask yourself, have I done everything that I could possibly do? For me, I noticed just to get into the specifics, I noticed that for years and years. As an actor, I really wasn't aware of the materials that were being pitched on my behalf. Things like Actors Access, LA Casting, those sorts of different houses. And it wasn't until recently that I really started checking the materials to make sure they're up to date. And right. Lo and behold, here do I find, here are the relics of all these old agents that I've been with. And here's, you know, misattributed credits or missing credits or all these kinds of things. So, you know, for me, I think before you go blaming others, just like in life, you got to ask yourself, have I done everything? And for me, that really comes down to not just 90%, not just 95%, not even 99%, but am I doing 100% of what I could possibly do to help my case? And then at that point, then I've turned the blame to the representation, and then you make decisions from there. But fortunately, it hasn't gotten to that.
When you came out here 2 years ago, and I think I just briefly heard you say you did some lifestyle rearranging or something like that. So was there a moment or something that triggered you saying, I need to be more on track and I need to devote 100% to my acting career rather than when I came out here and it seemed like more fun and games? Or?
Right, yeah. So coming from New York to LA, there's a big difference in terms of the priorities that are in place. Or at least the perceived priorities that are in place in terms of what's important in your career and what are the things that need to be at the top of the list. In New York, and again, these are implied, so it's not as if this is an explicit thing that's handed down through by anybody. But in New York, it seemed that there was a real emphasis on training, technique, and craftsmanship. And in LA, moving here initially, it seemed like the priority was really on profile and who you're hanging out with, how you spend your time, what parties you go to, who you know, these sorts of things. And I'm guilty of falling into all those traps initially. And I thought, you know, there are these things that are sort of, they look very similar to success, and they feel very similar to success as well. Rubbing shoulders with certain people, you know, being involved in certain conversations, you know, being privy to certain knowledge, but ultimately it's sort of like a mirage in the desert, because you're not really left, you're still left thirsty at the end of the day, and you find that those relationships are temporary at best, and so for me, it really took a paring down of my life. It really took me simplifying in every and all aspect to really get the work where I want it to be and where I want it to stay, and it's a sacrifice. But I think that going back as long as humans have been around, I mean, you got to sacrifice for what you want.
Would you say you've had to become more of a lone wolf?
Oh, absolutely.
Excuse the expression, but yeah.
No, I mean, yeah. I mean, uh-huh. If I said that, he would laugh at me. But yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I think that's the exact term that you have to be. You know, it's funny because I don't look at LA and Hollywood as a place that you necessarily make a life per se. It's more. I hesitate to use this simile, but it's more like a battleground of sorts, in the sense that, you know, you're here to accomplish an objective, and you're here to be the best that you can be, and hopefully you're here to do the best work that you can do, and those being your priorities, and with that in mind, you know, anything that detracts from that, I mean, really has to go. And so I think you really have to hold a very bright and very honest light on your life. And ask yourself, is this habit, is this behavior, is this thought process, is this relationship serving, you know, ultimately my goal and my ambitions? And if the answer is no, it's got to go.
So. Yeah, it's easy to be distracted by any kind of stupidity in around your life. And I think, I'm not from here, but I think just Los Angeles is just such, so many people are that I'm talking, actors, whatever, they're just like, oh yeah, I'm trying to do my own work. But then they just find any kind of reason not to do it. And so it's all about dedication, passion, and focusing. Even for me in Montreal, that's the only thing I do 24/7. I don't really have friends, I have some, I pick them, I have one here in LA, and I just focus on the work, because otherwise it's so easy to just spread yourself.
Okay. Do you think if you knew how lonely it is trying to do that, you would have done it years ago? Because I think people don't realize how you end up isolating yourself by focusing.
I love that.
Oh, you do? Okay.
It's a very uplifting question.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, I think it's one of those things that you have to find, like I've always prided myself in finding comfort in the uncomfortable. And I think that if you can find a way to be happy and whole and complete when you're alone, I mean,
you will be at your strongest when you are alone.
That's right, and life's gonna have a hard time rattling you if you can go, if you have a center that's your own and that is and that it's 100% your own.
Like in the film, it says at one point you need to be emotionally balanced. And that's exactly about it. Once you are balanced, you can deal. If you can indulge yourself being lonely and you can make peace with yourself, then you can attack anything in the world. And you know, you're gonna have a strong something.
Constitution. I don't know, but I'll tell you, there's a line that he wrote in the script that says, you know, things can't be perfect all the time. And for me, I'm not sure if that's the line you were going for, but for me, I cannot tell you how many times I think that on a daily basis or on a weekly basis. Resiliency, like you said, the balance is so important because you're gonna have everything thrown at you. You're gonna wake up on the day of your screen test and you're gonna have a migraine, or you're gonna have food poisoning, or you're gonna have a fight with your significant other the night before, or you know, you're gonna show up to your premiere and you're gonna have, you know, you got dust in your eye or something. I mean, it's just the way it's gonna work. And if you can roll with those punches, you know, and if you can have that strength inside,
you can achieve anything.
You know.
Actually, the line that I was going to quote was not that line. It was, excuse my language here, fix your shit before you waste someone else's time, something like that, which I loved that line. But it can be applied to many things, not just a relationship.
Totally.
And so that's where I was kind of going with that.
It's funny you say that, because that's sort of my excuse on why I don't date right now. Is not other people. It's me fixing. And since we're now speaking in French, me fixing my own shit before I just unload it on somebody else. Because I, you know, it's sort of one of those things where you want to be able, as it does apply to relationships, you want to be able to give someone your all. You want to be able to give them your time and attention. And when you're after a pursuit like this, you know, your time and attention is hard to come by.
Very true. And that's what I was saying. It is a lonely journey when you focus, whether it's an entrepreneur, we've talked to people that are working in tech or different things. And it is a lonely thing because people end up falling away because you're always busy trying to do stuff. And it's not because maybe they're mad at you, but you just isolate yourself.
But the best example are people that are always surrounded by people. They are so afraid to face themselves. And that's the whole point. That's why I think is the most gratifying.
Yeah,
there you go. Yeah. That when you have that, you can totally get everything that is on your way and just break through them. But as soon as you are afraid to face yourself, to face your demon, there's no way you're going to be able to make it, I think, in this business. You're just going to be pushed left and right, and you're going to be so scared and screaming, oh, I want to quit. Where's my plan B? So.
Right. And it can be applied to filmmaking as well. So fixing your whatever, your stuff, before you... So
focus.
It sounds
it's
like
being focused. That's the main thing.
Well, it's acting sort of beautiful in the sense that any problems that you have in your personal life will manifest in your work, and those kind of the weaknesses, the proclivities, all those things, they show up in the work, and so the work becomes sort of the ground with which you address these things within yourself. And so the takeaway is pretty remarkable. If you're really putting yourself into the work that you're doing, the amount that you can learn about the way that you approach problems or the way that you react in situations. I mean, I know I was surprised over the course of the film, especially considering going back to the audition with the vulnerability. I mean, how easy it was for me by the end to just fly off the handle at Alyssa. Like, it was cathartic in a way, but it also surprised me, and it was something that, you know, since then, I've really gotten to know intimately that side of myself, a side that maybe I denied before I met Pascal and started doing and did this film.
Right. They say that therapists should also be in therapy. Do you think that actors should be in therapy? Because there are things that maybe are blind. You know, they say we have this like shadow self that we don't see.
Sure.
But so. I think acting or doing a film, like even for him when he was, I think he was going through something when we did the film and a lot of thing, but he brought that and it worked. And sometimes it didn't work and I have to refocus him a little bit. But when sometime he was in this kind of dark zone, he just fed from it and it worked. So I think screw therapy, just, you know, act in a film or something.
Yeah, I only laughed at the therapy line only because I feel like maybe actors shouldn't be in therapy. Only because I feel like the greatest gift that you can give audiences is that vulnerable, messy, chaotic, ugly side of yourself.
And you want to discover yourself takes after takes after takes. And if you know all the answer right away, there's nothing left to be discovered.
I don't even know if there is such a thing as a well-balanced actor.
Then he'll trust me.
Or artist, maybe, in general, I don't know.
So if you're one of these keep calm and carry on type people, then that's not really gonna translate.
I mean, if it works, then God bless you. Maybe, I mean, I'm sure that there are people that can prove me wrong on that, and if so, like, caps off to you, but I'd say for everybody else, let your freak flag fly.
Tyler, how did you hear about On the Horizon?
Okay, I heard about On the Horizon through my manager. He told me, he said he has this great script on his desk that he thought would be perfect for me, and that he thought that it's something I could really bring something to. And that was first and foremost, that was the primary attraction to the script, was this idea of being able to bring something unique to it. And in reading the words, reading the material, that became very apparent to me that there was a perspective that I could bring that I felt was unique and was not necessarily in the text explicitly, but through our conversations and through our dialogue we developed. And I'll tell you, it was the I remember getting the phone call from him for the first time in the driving in LA traffic, and the amount of passion that oozed from him, the amount of excitement. I mean, He got me excited. I mean, my heart rate started going, and I had to pull over on the side of the 101, which is fairly illegal. But I was in such an intense conversation with him that I had to give my full attention, and I knew that I was in safe hands the moment that I heard his enthusiasm and excitement.
And what was so funny is that, and I think he knew. I told him is that for me, he got the role, even though he did the audition. And even if he didn't kill it, because he kind of went to a wrong direction, and then I focused him back. But just from the conversation on the phone, he got it. But I think, what, 1 week I made him wait or something?
Oh, yeah, he made me sit on it. Yeah, for sure. And at this point, like, I'd really, like, I tend to be pretty reserved with getting projects. Like I said, trying to be divorced from the outcome. But at this point, I had fought for this one. I had rushed home and done this Skype audition where I was screaming at a webcam, which is on with him on the other end. And I'm thinking, like, if this guy makes me do all this. But, you know, again, you got to be prepared for anything in this business. So, yeah.
But that was the whole point. For me, I was just trying to see, because I don't care if you have to do the audition in person or via tape or whatever, as long as you bring it. And for him, it was about, do you listen to what I'm saying? So he did a version. I was just like, no, do this instead. And I was kind of directing him. And then I was reading the text. I was like, and because the reader that he was not right, that person didn't get the right tone for the Elissa. Right. So when I did it with him, I was Elissa. And then I was like, boom, inside of him. Oops. And then, but then for the audition, it just worked like crazy. And we did it, what, 3-4 times?
Yeah.
But at one point, I was just playing with him. I was just wanted to see, can he still go on and go on and go on? And he was. He was always getting better and better. So, and then I was like, yeah, he got it. And just physically, he fit Casey. And he listened to me. And it was all about passion. And I think he felt the same thing for me. And it was very versatile. So as soon as I talked to him, I was just like, yeah, Ian. But I'll torture him a little.
Yeah, yeah. He had me wait a little bit. But I was very excited to get on board with this one.
Yeah, no, it's so far in my career is the best choice so far. So,
And for me as well. I mean, I've never gotten to pour as much of my heart into something. I've never gotten to, like I said, by the time all the work was done, by the time we had done all the preparation, there was not a whole lot of acting on screen. And I mean that in the most positive of senses, mm-hmm. It felt effortless because of everything that we had done up to that point.
And plus, too, you needed to know that you could work with someone in such close quarters. I mean, you said you had a crew of like three people maybe with the
sound.
Yeah,
that's another thing. For me, it's always to find people that I can be friend with. It's not just work. Yes, it is work, but at the same time, it's such a tight crew. So it is family. It is like a boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever kind of relationship. You need to be able to just, because I think most days was like 10 hours a day. But then after that, it's having a good time, having just you are with those person 24/7. There's no trailer or whatever. It's like shooting a documentary live, but we have a schedule. So it was just, for me, it's a very intimate process. And when it works, then I think it makes something magical.
And we had some real kismet occur on the set. One scene in particular in the White Desert. Here we have this without giving anything away. We have this whole thing building, and these tensions rising, and then on the horizon there's a storm building, and that yeah. And here's this very threatening weather coming in, and we only have this day to shoot this scene. We only have this window to shoot it. And so it's go, go, go. We got to get this done one way or another. And I think it was something about that ticking clock that really got us to the edge of where we needed to get to. And
because I had my plan. Okay, now we're going to do a wide, then it's going to be a close up. But then we hear the rumble. And then I see my sound guy with this metal pole in the middle of the white dish. And I was like, there's someone who's going to die. It's going to be that guy.
That's right.
And then we see that storm coming. And I'm like, yeah, we don't have time. Just everything's going to be a long one take. And the fact that it was, I think it makes him better. It makes just everything was way more alive. And I think it works with that scene that there's no interruption. And with the storm coming, the clouds was forming, and I think it's everything happens for a reason. When you shoot something like that, everything happens for a reason, and it worked. I think that's the best scene of the film.
It's like the sense of urgency that was a result of Mother Nature itself, which is like, there's no substitute for that. It was incredible. Yeah. We got lucky.
We did.
Pascal, why did it take you 2 years to cast your two lead actors for On the Horizon?
It took around 1 year.
Only 1 year, okay.
Yeah. It's because we had people in France, we had people in, the whole cast was divided because the story is in part France and a part Salt Lake City. And mostly, that's the thing, when you have to deal with a low budget scenario, then you have a certain bubble of actors that you can get to, otherwise you cannot pay them. So mostly all of them, sometime I knew them from before, but for Casey, for Elissa, it was a long process just trying to find, for example, Elissa, to find someone who got this badass, I don't give a attitude, and that is naturally, that it's not forced. You need to have, like him, this is Casey, you know, Tyler is Casey. It's not something that you create, it's not something that you can fake, and because we had amazing actor, who did great for the audition, but when you think, is she Elissa? It didn't work. It didn't have this kind of magical spark. And so when I found that, you know, Elissa, it worked. But it takes time to go through, because we had 50,000 people who auditioned, like who submitted their stuff, and we auditioned at least 1,000, 2,000. It was a lot of people. And you can see so many people that are horrible, and you can see some people that are amazing, but they don't fit. And so, for him, he was the last one. I went through everyone, and I had another Casey who, now that I'm thinking about it, it would have been horrible with the Elissa that we had. And so he just popped out of nowhere, and I talked to his manager. We talked on the phone, and it was just easy in 2 seconds. But it takes time to find people who look like star, who can have good chop, and the timing of the schedule. And so it's all of these.
You've talked about having the it factor. Do you think people are kind of made that way, or like born that way?
Yeah,
or do you think
so.
They can adopt that?
No, you have it or you don't. It's not something that you can create. You can be a better actor, you can have more experience, but that it that makes you interesting right away, like for example, if you watch Tyler for the first time and you say, oh, you got something, it draws you to the screen, it's him. It's just the aura, the energy around you. So yeah, you have it. It's not something, that's the thing that is so frustrating, is that when you watch actors who are great. And I had like three people who was auditioning my last three for Elissa. They were amazing acting wise, but they didn't have this magical that was Elissa. So when I found her, Cindy, it worked. It just, she had maybe less experience, but everything, who she was, killed for the acting chop for the rest, because it was just naturally for her. So when it's time to be angry, it was real anger. When it's time, to run, it was real running. So that's what I'm saying. You know, when you, for me, when I'm casting someone, they need to fit the part right away. It needs to have this hit factor, but it needs to represent that part naturally.
What do you think about that, Tyler, in terms of the it factor? Have you ever heard other people refer to you as having that? And what's your take on that?
I mean, again, I'm flattered at the association. On whether or not it can be manufactured, that's interesting.
Because actors are such chameleons that maybe their own self is this insecure sort of person, but they can really put off this air of this charismatic, like, I don't care. I mean, that's tough to do.
I think in that vein, I think you're right. I do think at some level, it really comes down to what it means to have it naturally. Like, in the sense that, is it still natural if it's manufactured? I think it actually is. Because I think that the idea that there exists an actor, or that Brad Pitt or Johnny Depp or any of these guys walk around and have no insecurities and never have an off day, or never not charismatic, or never not good looking. I mean, you have to imagine that there are humans just along with everybody else. And so, I think that some of it is inborn, but I certainly think that, you know, a lot of it is based upon your reaction to your own weaknesses. And is that something that you succumb to, or is it something that you build upon? And I think it's those that have built upon their weaknesses that have that it factor, because there's a certain sparkle in their eye that says, I know exactly where my weak spots are, but I have taken steps to address them. And I think that's where it comes from.
How much time did you have to prepare for your character, Casey, on the Horizon?
It was about 2 months, would you say?
Yeah.
2 months. And we talked every day. I mean, we became very close at that time period. I mean, we talked nearly every day, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, it's important. You have to have, like, we've talked about, when you need to have this kind of friendship. Because for me, if I feel that it's just purely work, don't talk to me, but I'm going to be there just for work and then I'm out, I don't want those people. It's important, because for me, that's, I like this guy, I want to work with him again. If it was just pure work, I don't really care about you, just we have something just too formal and professional-ish, I don't want that. I want this kind of freedom of, yeah, we're friends. If you need me, call me anytime. The other day, call me at like, whatever, 2 a.m. my time. It's like, hey, I got an amazing news. I'm like, hey, cool, no problem. You need to have this kind of connection.
That just happened, actually. That just happened
when it was like this, a good 2 months of preparation that we went through everything costume-wise, that jacket, and he showed me some jacket.
We looked at so many jackets to arrive at this jacket.
It's a nice
the
jacket.
The squeakiest jacket ever.
Yeah, it was
nice,
just,
though.
And it's from Montreal.
It's from Montreal.
There you go.
It came from a thrift shop.
Oh, cool.
And it's got.
But he took the time. That's the thing. I like him because he took the time to. I had a vision for the boots, the jeans, the jacket, the hair, the this.
The car.
And yeah, the car, everything. So we took the time, and he was a soldier. He went online, took pictures, selfie. And I was like, yeah, no, it doesn't work.
And I don't
work.
Selfie. I try not to. So that's not a good look. But yeah, besides just the aesthetics, I mean, I was notebooking.
A lot.
We had precedent films that we had decided, or that he had handed down to me, and that we had spoken on, of films that we had felt that either reflected the tone of the film as a whole or the character.
But yeah, but that's the thing. Almost what every 2 days, whatever, it was important for me to go over the script. What is your thought? Do you have any question? Is there lines that doesn't make sense for you? Is there a thing you would like to change? For me, I'm always open to anything, because I don't want to be a dictator. I want to be, he's an artist. I want him to bring his artistry to my film. And so anything, I'm like super wide open. And when we were shooting at the hotel room, we came with his note, oh, that scene, I don't know. I think, what about this? And it was way better. So it's important to be open, to have this kind of a collaboration. Otherwise, you're killing the film if you're trying to be a dictator all the time. No, this is my idea, my writing, my this, my that. I'm like, no, I don't care. Just use it, twist it, make it better. And even in the big white desert scene, he tweaked some words just to make it more natural for him. Sometimes the way I write, it's very Frank English, French Anglo. So I needed that sometime, a guy, a pure English, to just make it more natural.
There's some poutine grease on the script pages sometimes, yeah.
At what point did you two meet in person? After all these phone calls and these Skypes? And
the first time shooting.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was like, let's shoot. Mm-hmm. It was the same thing for everyone. I never did a casting in person. It was always via Skype, Facebook, whatever. And then it's like, let's go, we shoot right away.
Because you were in Montreal, and so you would call.
It's money-wise, but I don't believe that you're going to be better if I'm in the room. I really believe that. I think that Skype, whatever, and I think you're going to be better if you're doing it live with me than if you're just trying to have a reader with your paper. It's like, I don't know. I think and he was better when we did it together because I can really tell him what to do, the direction to take, change this, try this, think about this, about the character, and it was better. So. This is my method. It doesn't mean that it works for everyone, but for me it works, and I've been doing the same thing for 15 years and it's been kind of working so far. So,
to Pascal's credit, I mean, he was very open to the collaborative element of filmmaking, and I think that's very often lost in actors' minds, where you're aiming to please, you're really just aiming to get the approval of whomever it is you are seeking, whether it be casting, producers, the director when you're on set. And I think it works best, and I think that it's the nature of this business to be a collaborative effort, and as such, he's bringing things to the table and I'm bringing things to the table, and I feel like that's the responsibility of the actor. That's really what you're getting hired for, is bringing those sorts of choices and those sorts of even contentions to the table. And in that way, you it's like the Hegelian dialectic, you know?
Yeah, I always believe that for me as a director, I want to be surprised. I want to be like an audience. So I'm like, I'm giving you your circle of direction. This is your bubble to play with. Go have fun and then impress me and then bring something that I didn't think about. And you did a couple of things that I was just like, oh, that's way better than what I could have written or something.
Well, Pascal, you've said that you put a lot of yourself into every story.
Yeah.
So did you give Tyler a backstory about Casey, whoever you envisioned his wounds were that the audience doesn't necessarily know, but that might be the reason for his rage in the film or different dynamics?
Did we do a lot of backstory? I think it was mostly my backstory that I told you about.
Yeah, and then he left the specifics to me.
Yeah.
Really, which was cool, because in that way, if I totally tried to absorb his story off of this, it would have been too impersonal for me. So it was more of drawing upon, okay, what place in your life were you at, and where is that reflected in the script, and then for me to sort of ally that up with my own experiences and then bring those to the table. Because if I just tried to live his story,
It would have been different.
I would be a French Canadian. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but
filmmaker. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, I'd be on the other side of the camera.
Yeah, but that film is super personal for me, but that's why it was for me important that I told him my backstory of why Casey is like that because of me, and the same thing for Elissa and all those people. So I gave them to everyone a little backstory, but at the same time, I'm a big opener to just go off on this is your character. As long as you fit my vision, I'm fine with it. And if there's something wrong, I'm going to move you around, refocus. Yeah. But it's important for him. He's the one living it. I'm the one behind the camera trying to do something great, but he's the one making him alive and making choices. So it's important that he lives Casey.
And some of the best moments really were when I would go to him, I'd say, hey, I'm going to try something here. And he'd say, do you want to tell me what it is? And I'd say, nope.
No.
And then we would just do it, loved it or hated it.
Yeah,
but he gave me the freedom and the space to be able to try things, and that was what made working on this film such a luxury, really, as an actor.
On the last shoot, were you sad to see Casey go?
Casey Taylor.
Casey?
No, he's right here. So it's no, but was this was a sigh? No, I was not really sad. It was more like a relief that he's never going to be away. That's the thing. I'm still him. He's still Casey, and he's going to live on now for the film, and so he's going to, I'm sure, hope that it's going to affect some people. So, no, I think he's just going to grow and grow, and I think now in a society that Casey is everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Is it hard
does
to
that
let
make
your...
sense?
It does, but I'm just wondering, is it hard to let a character go, especially if it's close to who your story might be or some feelings you have inside?
A little bit, but then after that you go with the editing and then you transform it again and then it's the release of the film and all that. So there's always some new ways of reliving it. And I'm sure in my next one there's some, you know, there's going to be a new Casey.
Sure.
New character that's going to be another part of me. So, no, I think, no, I'm good with it. I'm not going to cry over it.
For me, from a different side, it is sort of difficult to leave the character behind in the sense that certain affectations, certain feelings that I had built up in myself, I couldn't shake them right off the bat. I mean, there's a lot of things too, and like when you develop a relationship the way that we did on the film between Casey and Alyssa, you know, there's a lot of carryover on something like that, and you. I mean, you really got to remember that it's a job, and but yeah, I mean, you ask yourself, I mean, you feel those feelings later, and even though you can remember creating them, I mean, it's an interesting process. I mean, it's a very intimate process doing a love story of the variety that we did, and it was taxing on me personally. I could probably use some therapy after.
But I think what is great is that's why I'm not sad to let it go. It's because I love this kind of melancholy feeling about that. It's kind of a souvenir. It's just it's out there, and I love this kind of a melancholy sadness of I wish I can go back, but then that's the beauty of it. I don't want to go back. Now it's done. I did the best that we could, and now the next one is going to have a new souvenir, new memories that is going to be different. But I don't know. I love this melancholy.
There's a beauty in the longing.
Exactly.
And the sadness, yeah. Barring your audition for On the Horizon, not necessarily referring to that one, but maybe you can bring that in. When you do a Skype audition and you're doing a read and maybe there's someone on the other end reading with you, maybe not, what do you like about it? What works for you? What doesn't work?
I mean, it definitely presents its challenges for sure. You know, a big thing with auditioning is being able to connect with the reader. Connecting with a reader via medium like a computer is a little more challenging. I mean, there's certain things that you can't utilize that you would in the room, say your physicality, say proximity. Those sorts of things really don't come into play as much in the Skype format. However, that being said, there is something sort of freeing about doing it within a space that you're comfortable in, and sort of having the detachment from the room, as it were, because a lot of actors get intimidated by the room, and rightfully so. The room can be very intimidating. In this case, the room being virtual was sort of a safe haven for me. So, but here he is going, you know, she's really pushed you. She's really gotten you past that point. You know, she's really this. And I'm sitting there screaming at a webcam, just screaming, just spittle coming out of my mouth, the whole thing. And he's yelling at me to push it. And here I am. And funny enough, a neighbor actually came to me after that and said, is everything okay? And I just said, well, I'm an actor. And that explained everything.
So. But I think that's the best way. If you can make it via Skype or via webcam, imagine what you're going to do in real person with, you know, when you're going to be in that moment. So I think that's a way better test. If you can kill it via webcam or even a video submission without a reader or something, and you kill it, then you're going to be amazing when it's going to be time to do it live.
Well, I think, did you have someone read with you before? And then, Pascal, you
yeah.
did a second one, and
yeah.
you had things to bring to it.
Yeah, exactly. You did. You picked someone, and for me, it didn't really work. I was just like,
I hired someone.
For real? You wasted money on this?
Yeah.
Jeez. So, but yeah, it really
I
didn't.
I think she's great, personally.
But yeah, it didn't have this angry vibe that I was looking for. So that's why I was like, let's do it live, just you and I. So we did it 4 or 5 times live. And for me, it was to see him reacting to what I was saying and to push him. But then you were not afraid. I think you were. And the more we were doing it, he was jumping on.
Yeah, it took me hours to calm down after that.
Sorry.
Well, maybe she wasn't Alyssa. Maybe she was great. But I know that there were specific things within the relationship, and we won't give them away in this interview, but that we're definitely pushing one another's buttons.
Yeah.
So you knew who Alyssa was and her backstory
exactly.
And those specific things.
No, I understand. You know, the reader did the best with the knowledge about the story. So for me, I think it's just easier if I'm doing it. But
She just read a little more melancholy. She was a little more down energy, where Alyssa is more of a fighter.
Exactly.
And that was something that we had to address, and that's what we did via Skype.
It was just missing the storm a little bit.
Yeah.
Right, okay. So you stirred up the storm.
That was the storm.
And yeah. And so what did you see in his Skype audition that worked, and then maybe you said you had to keep refocusing him or something?
Because in the beginning, what you were just, like you said, you were down. He was just, when you watch the scene in the film, he's all over the place, screaming and everything. And for him, it was just like...
I was playing the loss of the whole thing,
almost like a victim,
and the pleading and and that sort of thing, and it was because I hadn't yet been able to figure out Casey yet.
Didn't read the whole thing,
and I was still at this point of figuring out who he was, and I didn't realize the fight that he had inherent in him, and I saw him as being more a victim of Alyssa's behavior as opposed to an active participant in his own situation.
Are most directors afraid of actors?
I'm not afraid of this guy. But that's I go back to my point of, I'm not gonna work with those type of people. I prefer to have someone less popular or something, but I'm gonna have the best time. Because if I don't have the best time, for me, you know, doing this, it's fun. I don't want to feel like it's work. As soon as I feel like it's work, I don't want to do it. So that's why I need to find the right people who's gonna have this, you know, friendship. So each person I need to have, do I connect friendship-wise with them? Otherwise, I don't care if you're like Russell Crowe or something like that. If you're difficult to work with, or I feel that we're gonna bump head, then no, screw that. And I've learned a lot with that film. I've learned a lot casting wise, and for myself, those type of people that I connect and doesn't connect with, and so that's why I say with Tyler, this was the best experience that I had. And even other people, like for example Noelle Tolan, who's doing a little role in the film, she was amazing, and other people like Jed Harlow and stuff like that. So yeah, my casting process is all about, do I connect with them? If not, you're out. I don't want that, because I know it's going to be just miserable on set.
What do you start to see, like what are the little signs that you go, you know what, maybe this isn't the right match?
I think it's just energy. You just, when you talk to that person, do you have the same vibe, the same flow? When you say something, do you laugh, or is just, I'm saying a stupid joke and you just don't, there's like the crickets. So just those little symbol, I'm like, funny wise it's not working. And then, oh yeah, you're a great actor, but then when we talk, there's just some kind of coldness. And when there's, I don't know, for me, maybe I'm just too emotional about it, but at the same time, I don't care. I want to have fun. I want it for him to have the best time. He doesn't want to work with a shitty director who's just going to yell at him all the time. Even if it's for work, he's going to, you know, I know he's going to bitch in my back all the time about it. So, no, but it's crucial. It goes both ways. Everyone needs to have a great experience. Otherwise, yeah, people will yap and they're going to say, yeah, it was not a fun experience. And you want to make sure you have always the best reputation.
Do you think actors are afraid of directors? You knew this was going to come.
I did. I did. I think it's paradoxical. I think by nature, yes, because they're in a position of authority, and they're, as with any authority figures, well, and authority figures in certain spheres, you want to impress them, you want to look good in front of them. But at a certain level, no offense, Pascal, but you kind of have to have a certain irreverence at the same time, because again, it goes back to doing it for you. You know, I did want Pascal to be happy, and I do want Pascal to be happy, but at the end of the day, if that's what I was rooted in, if that's what my performance was rooted in, if that's what my rapport on set was rooted in, I don't think that I would be the person or the actor that I am. And so I think, I don't know, the older I get, I find that real truth is paradoxical in nature, and this is no exception. So yeah, I'm both terrified of directors and also, screw them.
But it's, but that's the thing, it's important, as long as for me, I know my vision and I know exactly what I want. Even at one point, sometimes we were trying something and it was just too funny. I was like, yeah, Tyler, focus. And I was rolling him back because I know what I want. I got, you know, it's fun and game, yes, but we have work to do. And that's why it needs a fine line of, we can have a great time, but at the same time, let's work and let's make sure that you do what I'm asking you to. But I'm doing this in a fun, loving, communicative environment. And if you don't have that, I think that's where he's going to be afraid of directors. Because the fact that it's super open, that he knows that, hey, just knock at my door, come and talk to me if you're freaking out, and I'm going to be there. I'm never going to say you cannot come and see me. So I think that opens doors to let go of that fear.
But he does know how to crack the whip, so.
I did it. I did some.
He cracks the whip.
Well, it's difficult because you were on a tight timeline. You were in some, you know, natural places where you had a storm was coming and you had very few people to work with, so I'm sure there were some tense moments, but...
Yeah, for example, that exact scene. He was driving the bike, having the fun with Elissa. I was just like, I was freaking out. I was seeing the storm, and we didn't have like a microphone or something, so I was driving the Jeep, trying to run and go. We were just like Mass and Cat, driving around in the desert, trying to refocus the whole thing.
You give me a 64 Triumph on the Bonneville Salt Flats, I'm going to have some fun with it.
That's where he says I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
But
it worked out.
It worked.